My name is James Kitchen, and I'm a sculptor. I've learned over the years to trust my gut, my intuition, because what I do to get into that zone, or whatever you want to call that, is I play with the metal.
Look at this, this is good stuff here.
You realize certain parts just are similar, or a shape suggests something, and often something I never would have thought about except by just playing and juxtaposing the pieces. I tell people I'm a clumsy magician, because sometimes it happens, and I'm almost a witness to being, I'm putting the pieces together, and sometimes I surprise myself. I always feel like I'm part historian and part archaeologist. I find these old hunks of metal. My favorite are the old farm pieces. I grew up in Wisconsin around farms, and there's some kind of connection there. You find these old pieces, each one has a narrative, each one has a history, and they're all worn, and some of them are handmade, some of them are 200 years old.
So here, let me start it up for you.
Every day I walk an hour in the morning, and it's started out as just exercise and whatnot, but I've realized that hour I spend thinking about things without any interruptions. There's no phone, nobody's bothering you. You're walking, the blood is pumping, you're getting oxygen. It's the best time to think things through. I tend to think about what I've read, and in the case of creating the universe, I had just read a biography of Albert Einstein. I fell in love with this guy. When I grew up, I thought that there's just this old guy with white hair, and you know, that's what you think of Einstein. But when you read about him, when he in his 20s and 30s, he was something else.
The professor had a theory as to how they could land, but before he and the captain...
What he said struck me, and I kept thinking about it and thinking about it. He said, imagination is more important than knowledge. And I thought about that, and I said, but what does that mean? Imagination is more important than knowledge. And I thought, that is my strong suit, imagination, creativity. And he gave me the confidence to think, I'm going to intuit the answer to the universe. I went out, and I've been collecting pieces of metal for years, and in one day, it kind of just all coalesced. There's no better feeling, except for when you wake up, and then you think, now what do I do? Originally from Wisconsin, I say that with an accent. My whole family, actually, my sister's a very good artist, my brother's a very well-known cartoonist. My mother is incredibly artistic. She does oil paintings, cuts out little pieces of paper and makes these little collage things. Definitely you can see a genetic connection, but I think it all goes back to Franz Margaret, my grandfather. Came from Hungary in 1903. He was a metal worker. He did these incredible Art Nouveau, and he did tables and lamps and all kinds of things, and I feel just a real strong connection to his artistry. I believe that his father and his father before him did metal work. I was very fortunate at Paradise City last year. I met Evan Plotkin. And we talked about maybe putting a couple pieces at the building that he owns at 1350 Main Street in Springfield.
I met James Kitchen about a year ago, and we have established a great relationship in trying to develop a concept here where we create a gallery in the city. The city becomes sort of a gallery space for art. to show off his incredible work. It's all about public art and trying to create a new conversation about Springfield, a different narrative about Springfield, and it appears to be working because I think people are seeing these wonderful works of art and that are interesting and thought-provoking, and they stop in their tracks to look at it, sometimes to touch it and to ask questions, and they ponder it for a while, and then they go on their way, and it's a memory for them being here. Springfield has not seen anything quite like this in a long time, or maybe ever.
He said, well, I also managed this building here, 1550, and we took a tour through the different places throughout downtown that he either owned or managed. And the 1550 building was just, it used to be the federal courthouse, and it's incredible now. These big glass atrium, it's gorgeous. The building's gorgeous. And I thought, oh my gosh, I would love to be there.
I look at her and I say, Rapunzel, Rapunzel, let down your golden chains. I can't find words to describe it. To take some old pieces, such as the work that he takes, and turn it into these beautiful creations, which I am so proud to sell and have in the gallery. His artwork is here in Springfield, all on the various locations. You walk past it and they stop and they look and they go back and they look.
We actually introduced our visitors to James Kitchen's work in 2004. It was one of our most popular exhibitions. It's still talked about today. And then 6 years later, in 2010, we featured his magnificent work called Saturn outside on our museum green. And again, a very popular work. We had visitors streaming in always to look at the piece, spending 45 minutes to an hour examining it. And to have his work now in Springfield is just fantastic, because I think his artwork is so appealing to visitors. They find different meaning in it depending on what you're looking at and what experience you bring to the art. And it's really fun. For people in the art field, that's really what you want to be promoting to your audience.
It's a three-phase process. The first phase was I put 60 pieces inside 1550 Main Street. The second phase, I put 30 pieces all along Main Street, in and around Main Street. The third phase, which is actually pretty exciting for me, is I'm collecting metal from the city of Springfield, and I'm going to make sculptures specifically for Springfield out of local found objects. And the tornado, which happened just over a year ago on June 1st, one of the things that happened is there's the Armory building. In Springfield, they had this big Armory building, 50-foot high ceilings on this one building. These incredible big arches, their tornado came, knocked them down. Big twisted wreck. The company that was taking the metal away took three 12-foot high sections. And the 12-foot high sections each weigh 3,300 pounds. I fell in love with these, and I'm gonna marry the three pieces that I got from there together to make this really elegant looking base to some sculpture. And I don't even know what happens next, because I have to get metal, but I know I have the base. I'm excited because I don't know what's going to come on top, but that's going to be one of a few pieces that I'm making for the city.
We're rebranding the city and rebranding the properties that I'm involved with, and it's all in an effort to tell people that Springfield is on its way in it's a very positive direction that we're going in.
It's interesting where the cannon gets pointed. I first put that cannon in Williamsburg. I put it on the Beacon's Library lawn, and it was facing across the street. And one day the vice president of the bank called me over and he said, is that pointed at us? And it was really, it seemed concerned. I said, no, it's okay, it's got a flower in it. That's love, that's all. Child of the 60s, it's okay. And he said, I don't know, it looks like it's pointed at us. And he was concerned. I had to reassure him.
Where did he go? He became famous after he was at the Meekins Library.
That's right, yeah. He went on, he had a show in Springfield. And, he started showing more in craft fairs and things like that.
Right.
And he loves libraries, too. Yeah. That's the thing. I mean, I think it's not just that he had his art here, but it was really special for him and for us but special for him because he really likes libraries and he wanted to support the library. Later on, he gave us our mom with the birthday cake over there in the corner, and we love that. And then he brought his work and had it outside here, and
went to Northampton.
He wanted to give us something. He gave the library that really lovely.
She's
made
great.
A donation to.
She
to
is
us.
So great.
Yeah,
because some of his pieces are. Just imagine what it takes to make some of those pieces.
No.
Sculpting for me is a very intuitive thing, so it's hard for me to articulate. I can tell you that it starts with finding pieces of metal. So I go to Douglas auctions every week. I'm a regular there. I go to junkyards. I'm on first name basis with all the transfer station people. But my favorite place in the whole world, sometimes I'll find an old farm where the farmer lived through the Great Depression. That guy never threw anything away because, you know, that guy knows he might need that piece someday. You'll go to this farm, and there were transfer stations back in the 30s and 40s, and some corner of that farm is where everything was tossed. And there's usually an old 38 Studebaker or old tractor parts. To me, it's like St. Peter opens up the gates, and I'm in heaven because there's this whole section of just rusted old metal. All the hand-forged pieces that I find, somebody handmade that hinge. They handmade everything. The wheel rims, handmade. They still will work fine. 100, 150, 200 years later, they're still good.
This is made from really old railroad spikes. Age, they're all this beat up year after year trains and somebody pounding on them with a spike. So you find these things and you honor that. They make this sculpture I'm calling Day's End. And it's a feeling we all have. I don't care if you're a school teacher or whatever job you have, it's just you're coming home from work, it's called Day's End.
Every sculpture I make, I'm always have the radio on and I'm listening to music, and it's interesting. I'm usually listening to public radio, and sometimes late at night I'll be listening to bluegrass, sometimes it'll be jazz. The next morning I come out, open up the garage door, and it's like, what was I making last night? And I can see I'm affected. If it's jazz or if it's classical music, I can kind of see that led me a little bit one way or the other, and it's always interesting. But it's definitely, music is always a part of what I'm doing. That's just infused inside of me.
We live down the street from Jim, and he jogs every morning, and he passes my house singing at the top of his lungs. I usually come out in the street and I say, shut up already, Jesus, the neighbors are going crazy here. And he just tells me about some new project that he's got.
I've ended up with a lot of different professions in my life. I was a musician for many years. I love old antiques. I love history, and it all is in Green Lake, Wisconsin. I had an antique store for a while. I owned a moving company, Hernia Movers. I was the potentate of Toten Freight. I was a poet for a while. I self-published some poetry books, did some writing. When I owned my moving company, I told everybody I was a spatial engineer, and I could somehow get everything to fit in the truck that nobody else thought I could do. And I would marry the pieces together. And looking back, I realized I was just very good at spatial engineering and with music and poetry and assembling and finding connections. Somehow I've had a lot of disparate jobs, and they all kind of come together when I make my artwork.
I think he's found the right medium. I think that metal sculpture is exactly, you know, the blowtorch and metal pieces is exactly where he needs to be in terms of where he's going to go. And it's just exciting to follow his path. I think the last thing I heard, he did a bird that was 36 feet in height. I don't know how he even manages that.
Evan Plotkin, I sold him an idea of making a 30-foot high bird, which ended up being 35 feet high, which I made with the help of Deerfield Valley Refab in South Deerfield. We got recycled metal and we bent pieces. You start working with big pieces like that, it's a whole nother world, because I'm not just sticking things together, I'm actually fabricating. And then the sheer size of it required a crane. It's gonna be put at 1350 Main Street as one of the 30 pieces in downtown. And it's actually, I'm very excited. It's something about the scale of that, looking and walking around, it's pretty exciting. Right. And I had a small 2 foot high bird and I said, you know what, imagine this, Evan. And you know what, he not only imagined it, he had me do this. And I can't stop smiling because this bird, it's unfurled. The space, it fits it perfectly. It's just as I imagined it.
So now what's turned into, James did a few pieces, 30-something pieces, which culminates with the bird. And I said a good thing about this bird is you don't have to deal with bird droppings either. But look at the mosaic of the city of Springfield.
I think his art is quite varied. I think that he makes whimsical pieces, but he also does more serious work.
He makes figurative things so that you kind of get an idea of what he might be trying to make. It might be a penguin, or it might be something else, or a person. And then he also does things that are totally just in the mind and abstract. Right.
His sculpture is truly universal at this point. I think that he's ever reaching out. There's no telling where it'll end, you know? I think this is what we're seeing now in terms of his work is just kind of the beginning of where Jim is going to take it.
I find in life, you meet people and the connections are the same as with my metal. It's just the things kind of come together in ways you never would expect or anticipate. And it's always a magical process. And it fascinates me. To articulate how, when I read about physics and things and how they describe the randomness and all these things, that's always part of what I'm thinking about. And then how things connect on all these different levels. I only know the part that I'm really good at is with the metal and putting it together. That's the part that makes sense to me. Everything else, I marvel at. I marvel at it.
Drifting dreams, my feelings flow. I'm sure my memory's wrong. Western wind, when will the blow and steer me safely home? Oh, western wind, when wilt thou blow? Let the small rain down can rain. Christ of my love, were in my arms, and I in my pain.
In the courtyard ahead, a deadly intruder waits, an Indian cobra. Hood flares, poised to strike, it watches the kitten's approach. In the hair-raising game of tag, the unleopard's lightning speed proves more than a match for the slow-striking cobra. Could easily kill the snake, but she knows the cub's instant reflexes will keep it from harm.
Got the word, Long John Silver.